Well, hello there again.
Peoples, aliens, dogs, cats, wombats, hedgehogs, pangolins. Got a great drummer and a generally nice guy in Mike Kadnar today, who plays with Downfall of Gaia, The Number 12 Looks Like You, and Black Table. Mike splits his time between teaching, touring, recording, doing other studio work, and just generally multitasking and hustling his way around a pretty stacked schedule. So we get into touring with Dillinger Escape Plan, how he got the call to do both Downfall of Gaia and The Number 12 Looks Like You, as well as early stories about playing in concert band as a kid. I have some of my own I'll share one of these ridiculous days. Also navigating the ever-changing music business, playing festivals versus small venues, reminiscing about our first gigs and our first recordings and how often terrible they seem in hindsight, and our mutual fascination with Dillinger Escape Plan's original drummer Chris Pennie, who was and will always be one bad muffra. So here we go. Blast off, y'all. Crash, bang, boom.
Crowds go mad with joy.
Hello. Hi, hi.
Now, see, that's a radio voice. That's what I'm talking about, man. Quit drumming. Just go into radio. That's where the real money is.
Exactly.
Michael Kadnar, what's happening, dude?
How's it going? Good to see you.
Yeah, man. It's been a minute, man. We got
been way too long.
It has. Well, you've been a busy guy.
Trying to be. Yep.
Yeah, you're keeping it busy. I like that, man. How's it been going? How are the holidays? Were you touring? Were you in town? What's been going on?
Yeah, I was in town. Saw family. And before that, I was touring a little bit. Yeah, I was in Europe with Downfall of Gaia.
Okay, nice. And we'll get to how you joined that band. I previously knew you from playing in Black Table, one of your three, I guess, bands at the very least, right? Can we say three?
Three, yes.
Okay. Three pretty busy bands, it seems. So you're definitely staying busy, like I said. But what has been going on?
Yeah, we just did a tour with Black Table in Hexas.
Okay.
A U.S. tour. Coast to coast in September and October.
How long were you out for?
It was like 3 weeks, a little bit more than 3 weeks.
Nice.
And then, yeah, we have a few things with Downfall of Gaia this year, just flying festivals. And then the big thing coming up is the 12-year anniversary of Nuclear Sad Nuclear with The Number 12 Looks Like You.
Okay.
So we're doing 12 gigs up and down the coast, playing the entire record front to back for the first time ever. That's going to be...
Whoa.
All live, every song.
Really?
Yeah.
The Number 12 Looks Like You, first of all, as with most people who hear that name for the first time, are probably completely baffled as to what the fuck it means. And I looked it up and realized that it was a reference to a Twilight Zone episode.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, beyond that, how exactly did you end up in that band? Because admittedly, I was not too aware of that band until recently when I heard that maybe you were playing with them. I kind of went back and started listening to all the stuff and realized that they had put out a pretty good bit of stuff. So at which point did you end up getting into that band?
So, yeah, I mean, they were active for a while from, I guess, early 2000 to about 7 years ago. Then they broke up. They did four full-length records, and they decided to call it quits. They toured heavily, I mean, really heavily, so they were... Yeah, they were busy, so they had a hiatus for 6 or 7 years, and then the bass player of Black Table, DJ Scully, he was approached by the singer Jesse Corman.
Also plays bass in Dead Empires as well, right?
Exactly. Yep.
Yeah, man, you guys are all over the place.
Yeah, him and I have just been playing together for a while now,
nice.
Like four or five years, and Number 12 approached him to see if he wanted to be in the reunion.
Yeah,
and they really wanted a bassist and a drummer who already were in a band together, who had
chemistry,
who were playing together.
Yeah.
So he said, yeah, let's do it. And when I got the phone call, I thought it was kind of a joke. But
right.
Then, yeah, it became reality. And, yeah, we started playing with him about 2 years ago now. Just started auditioning, learning the songs. And, yeah, That's it.
Holy moly. Well, first of all, were you aware of much of their back catalog? Or once you got the call to do it, were you like, oh, I've got to do some stuff? I mean, it sounds like it's pretty quirky stuff, so you'd have to do your studying regardless to really get inside of it and to be able to execute those songs. But how familiar were you with it leading into getting the call?
Well, it was pretty surreal because I was a really big Number 12 fan.
Oh, really?
Growing up, yeah, through high school, through college. I even went to their final concert in New Jersey. Their final, it was at School of Rock.
Really?
So I was there, I met the guys. It was really exciting but sad because it was over. So then in retrospect, yeah, to get the offer was really surreal.
Wow.
And yeah, I had to hit the books. I transcribed the drum parts for every song.
Really?
Yeah. So
that's brutal.
It was brutal, but I felt like a lot of those old parts needed to be pretty much the same because it's so complex.
And, right.
Some of the drum parts are actually more like licks or hooks.
Yeah.
You know, they make the song, so I didn't want to switch things up too much.
But, yeah.
As we worked on the songs together as a band, we ended up editing things and tightening them up. But pretty much I'm playing those old parts the way they were written.
Yeah. Are you that versed in sheet music and written music to have transcribed it like that? Is that the route you went with it? Or
that's the route I went with it. I went to university for music. So I had to transcribe jazz, drum solos, all sorts of stuff. So,
oh, really?
And for me, it really helped to have it on paper, and then it's always there kind of as a backup. Let's say you don't play the song for a year or something, you can look back and you have all your notes.
Right.
Instead of just going by memory, then it's a little bit trickier.
Did you go to school specifically for music?
Yeah, I got 2 degrees, music and finance, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Would you say that your finances are doing pretty good these days?
So-so.
That's more complex than the music, I would say.
Yeah.
So how was it studying drums and doing all that, the academic side of drumming and music and everything?
It has its ups and downs. So it's, of course, really exciting to dive into jazz, let's say, and really getting deep into it. But when it becomes your job or your homework, it kind of takes the passion out at times. But looking back on it, I mean, I'm really thankful that I went through that and I have that background to be able to transcribe and to have that jazz side to bring to all my new projects.
Right. Which is hilarious because I wouldn't say that you're necessarily playing jazz these days.
Not a lot. Very seldomly, yeah.
Yeah. When you were studying jazz and going through all that, were you a fan of heavier music and more extreme drumming as well, or was that something you found post?
I was a fan before college, yeah.
Okay.
In high school, I was always into heavy music, into more extreme styles. And then when I started discovering jazz, I saw there's a lot of similarities between metal and jazz. I think they're two of the most extreme musics as far as musicianship and ability and composition, whatever.
Right.
So they kind of went hand in hand for me.
Yeah, the feel is the big one, you know?
Yeah.
And dynamics, obviously, in the form of jazz, super dynamic, and the whole concept of playing from the top down as opposed to the bottom up, in the sense that, you know, with rock or metal, et cetera, funk, R&B, pop, et cetera, you know, you're leading with your bass drum. It starts there. It's the opposite with jazz, you know?
Exactly.
You're sprinkling in bass drum licks, you know? So. Yeah. The concepts and the feels are very different, but some of the independence exercises and everything that you have to go through to get that, I think that's the crossover.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right? So what was some of the heavy music that you were into, I guess, when you were growing up?
Like I mentioned, I was into the Number 12. My favorite band of all time is Dillinger Escape Plan.
Yeah. I've seen them, I think, 15 or 16 times now.
Yeah, I think same here, something like that. and yeah, it's a shame that they're calling it quits, but I totally understand. They're at their peak, so they have these final shows coming up.
Yeah.
But other bands, I mean, I was into, growing up, like Tool, stuff like that.
Right.
Primus, Deftones.
Yep.
And now it's just
all over the place.
All over the place.
There's so much music out there.
Yeah, exactly.
I've said it before many times on the podcast. You know, when I think about super influential drummers within, you know, sort of heavier and or extreme music, Thomas Hike of Meshuggah will always come through because, I mean, Meshuggah more or less created its own genre with the whole djent movement and all that stuff. But in particular, the stuff that Chris Pennie was doing early on with the Dillinger Escape Plan, I've said it before and I'll continue to say it. No one was doing that shit prior to that.
No one was, and people are still trying to. And I mean, you can listen to that record, Calculating Infinity, and I don't know, it was what, year 1999?
Right.
And the stuff he's playing, it's still, in my opinion, untouched, that record. You know, you listen back to it, you even see him play it live. Yeah, a lot of drummers were influenced by that, but I'm still blown away by that record. Especially.
Oh, I mean, Irony is Dead has some killer drumming on it, and Miss Machine is out of control. Oh, yeah. I think Miss Machine is the next level of everything that he did. That was like the culmination of all the madness, and holy moly. I saw him quite a few times with Dillinger. You know, I saw him open up for Mr. Bungle the first time they ever went out and did a big tour, you know. And then to see them later hook up with Mike Patton and work with him on that EP was just crazyville. But that's awesome, man. I could see the Chris Pennie influence for sure. Yeah. It's if you're willing to dive in. Have you transcribed any of his stuff?
Very little. I mean, parts of what is it? Panasonic Youth. Panasonic Youth.
Yeah.
And 43% Burnt. Stuff like that. I try to find some stuff online so I don't have to transcribe it, but it's all pretty much garbage, like the stuff you just find on Google.
Right.
So it's on my to-do list.
Yeah.
Certainly. I would love to do a playthrough or something of one of his tracks, but we'll see.
I'd love to see it.
Yeah.
You at this point, you could do no shortage of playthroughs with all the bands that you're in. Just a medley of your own tracks.
Yeah, yeah.
That would be pretty cool. I'd be into checking that out. Now, Downfall of Gaia. Now, how did that come about? Because that band is based out of Germany.
Yeah, so basically, the first big tour we got offered with Black Table was with Downfall of Gaia.
Wow.
I was drumming in Black Table, and they basically asked us to drive them and tour with them and like provide a backline, stuff like this. So we agreed. They came to the U.S.
Gotcha.
And we did a 30-day tour, and we never met them or really talked to them beforehand, so it was a little bit nerve-wracking. But they got off the plane, and our guitarist and their guitarist were wearing the same shirt, same band, Samothrace. So we knew right away they were going to be good guys and we get along. We had the same taste of music. They're really nice. It was a great tour. And then immediately after that, their drummer, he said he doesn't want to tour anymore because they were touring a lot at that point.
Uh-huh.
So he quit. He left on good terms. And they couldn't find anybody that could tour as much as they wanted to in Germany.
Right.
Either someone had a job or they had other bands, so they couldn't commit. And I followed up with them a few months after the tour, and I said, hey, what's up, guys? How's the drummer search? Do you need anybody? I'll do it, kind of as a joke, you know, because I didn't think it would be really possible. And then the joke kind of ended when they're like, yeah, do you want to do these festivals for us? Like, we have a budget for you. We could fly you out, stuff like this. So it started like that. I did one tour in the festivals, and then after a few more months, they couldn't find anybody. I already learned the songs. They said, okay, do you want to be a full-time member? We'll just keep doing it this way. So I signed the Metal Blade contract, and I would just fly there. We would rehearse for a few days before a tour, stuff like this.
Wow.
So, yeah, it's been pretty exciting. I never thought that I would be in a band from another country, and it would actually work out. So,
that's amazing.
Yeah, so I've been really lucky with that.
Do you have to do a pretty good bit of homework outside of that to keep yourself up on it so that when you show up, you're as efficient as possible given the smaller time frame to rehearse?
Yeah, the first year, absolutely. I transcribed everything, the old records. I practiced to the CDs a lot.
Yeah.
And now it's gotten to the point where we'll write online. I'll program drums and we'll rehearse for recording in person, but at least we'll do our homework, you know, just programming, stuff like that. And a lot of it now is just maintenance because our set list is the last three records, pretty much, songs from the last three records. So I mean, we've done, I don't know, 200 shows probably over these last 3 years. So,
wow.
I mean, I have it memorized and it's more like maintenance now. It's not so much homework. It's just, okay, when we rehearse, we just play the set. Okay, we know it. Let's just turn it up. Let's remember it. So it's a pretty streamlined process at this point.
Nice. You mentioned going out there rehearsing, etc. You've done two records with them now?
Yeah, two records, and we're doing pre-production for the third one right now. So
nice.
We're doing demos, yeah.
What was it like going out there to, had you played, so you did shows prior to, and then they were like, all right, now we're going to do a recording, right?
Yeah, so we did a few shows, and then the first record I did with them was really interesting because I went there for 2 weeks, and we just rehearsed every day, 9 to 5. That was it. We went into this old World War II bunker.
Whoa.
That was rehearsal rooms now, just graffiti everywhere, just really.
Where in Germany is this?
Half the guys are in Berlin, half are in Hamburg.
Oh, okay.
So this first record we did in Hamburg, that's mm-hmm. where we rehearsed, and then we recorded in Cologne. But yeah, it was really, I've never done that before. Gone in and really practiced every day and wrote songs every day for 2 weeks straight. That was really cool. Usually with a band, you play once a week, twice a week, and you slowly write, you send demos. But this was, we had a few demos and we just played every day and we recorded, listened back, and the next day fixed things. So it was really cool.
When it came time to record it, did it go pretty efficiently? Like everybody was on it?
Yeah. I mean, we practiced to a click. We had the demos. We had all the lyrics written out. So when I got to the studio, the first record actually I recorded to the click, and they actually played guitar at the same time, with a scratch track with me, which was pretty cool. And then the second record, actually same thing. Yeah, we had the clicks all mapped out and they played along with me in the click. So it was pretty cool.
Are there tempo changes when you mentioned like tempo mapping or click mapping and stuff? Or is it pretty straightforward?
Yeah, for Downfall of Gaia, it's pretty straightforward. If anything, we would do like a gradual tempo increase if it's a groovy part, just 10 BPM, something like that.
Yeah.
So it would be automated, but it's pretty much the same.
Yeah.
Black Table's a little bit trickier, and then number 12, I think there's a lot of tempo changes and feel changes.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
So every band's a little different.
Now with Downfall going out to Germany and spending some time between, I guess, Berlin and Hamburg and recording there, etc. Do you have a preference of either place, or do you enjoy going out to Germany and hanging?
Of course, yeah. I mean, Europe's lovely, and they've been really welcoming. The band has been welcoming, and they the first time I went there, they even put a welcome home sign because I was there for 2 weeks, and they gave me a room. And at first, Hamburg was really comfortable for me because that's where I spent most of my time that first year. And then now more members are in Berlin, so it kind of flip-flopped. So now I know Berlin better, and it took me a while to really get used to Berlin, especially because it's a tough city, but you really need to spend some time there to get used to it. As for Hamburg, I think it was really easy to navigate right away.
Right. Yeah. I had some good times in Hamburg. I went to the Reaper Bahn.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I don't need to go into depth about my experience there, but it was an interesting time for sure.
Of course. Yeah. One of a kind over there.
Absolutely, man. Do you speak a little German having gone over there?
Oh, not at all.
Really?
I've been there so many times and spent so much time with these German guys in my band. And I know, 20 words. I'm really bad.
That's not that bad. Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's the easiest by any means.
Yeah, it's pretty,
language.
It's a pretty tough language. I can order a beer or some pizza. So that's good. I can count to 10. That's about it.
nice, man. Now with Black Table, like I said, that was kind of the first band that I knew you to be in. How did that band come about? Because y'all have been doing that now for, what, four more years?
4 or 5 years now, yeah. I mean, we've been doing it for a while. The real way that all started was the guitarist Ryan Fleming. Him and I met on MySpace, believe it or not.
Really?
Yeah, and his band Randall Flagg at the time was looking for a drummer. So I found him on MySpace and messaged him, and I joined Randall Flagg. And this was already their third or fourth drummer. And when I joined, then the other guitarist said, oh man, this is too much. So he just said, I don't want to keep doing this. So we started a band called Empire. It was Ryan and I, the singer of Randall Flagg, Adam, and then my friend Nikita was also doing bass. So long story short, we lost a lot of vocalists in that band, and we never did anything really substantial as far as recording.
Uh-huh.
We had like a 2-song demo, and then that was it.
Right.
And out of that, Ryan and Murs started Black Table, and I was already commuting to Jersey City for Empire to rehearse, and they said, oh, just play drums for us, please. Like, it was kind of a side project at first.
Right.
But then it escalated very quickly to being a full-time thing, and it overtook Empire, and we did a EP, found a bass player. Matt Mellon was our first bass player, and yeah, we did that EP, and that's it, so kind of just wasn't really a big plan. Like, all right, let's start this band.
Right.
It was just, oh, yeah, just start playing with us. At least from my perspective, they were writing for a while, you know, doing it. But yeah, so that's it.
Cool, man. Now with Black Table, would you say, like, I would say with Downfall, that's maybe sort of like a doomy sort of semi-ethereal black metal kind of medley of some kind.
Yeah.
And what would you describe Black Table as?
Yeah, a lot of people put us in this black metal umbrella, which is not really true. I don't think we ever thought we were a black metal band.
Uh-huh.
For us, it was always more experimental. I think the vocals are a little bit blackish, and there's some guitar work that's kind of black metal, but I think it's more experimental,
right?
Because we have some sludge, some doom stuff. It's really hard to just put one genre on it.
Right. Did you have much experience doing blast beats and stuff like that leading into doing the Black Table thing?
It's funny. I remember a few of the reviews from the EP, and a lot of them, if they ever talked about the drums, was they would say, recognizably, or there's really no blast beats on this. Like, they recognize that it's, oh, this is black metal without blast beats.
Right.
So the first, the EP, didn't have any blast beats. And then the second one, we added a little bit more. So I was never really a blast beat guy starting off. And then, especially when I joined Downfall, that's when I kind of got more into the blast beat world.
Right.
And when I joined Downfall, then it kind of influenced Black Table as well, at least the drumming.
Now, in regards to all three bands that we just talked about, what do you enjoy the most about playing in each of those three bands? And what do you find to be some of the more challenging aspects of the individual bands?
Okay. All three bands, I mean, they all serve a different emotional purpose for me. So Black Table, that's like my baby, because I started that band. It was my first, I don't want to say successful band, but first band that something happened.
Like, right.
We released albums, we toured. We had some positive feedback. So for Black Table, it's just, I was there for the beginning. So, it means a lot to me to play in it. And I always keep that in mind that, okay, this is my first, real band. For Downfall of Gaia, it's just very primal for me. I mean,
right.
I just hit as hard as I can for as long as I can. And it's just this primal release of energy and of everything. So I, that's that whole side of me.
Right.
And then for number 12, it's really back to my roots and to, math metal and just a lot of technical parts, not a lot of repeats. And we'll spend, hours on 1 second of music, just one fill, one guitar run.
Oh, that sounds so tedious. It gives me a headache.
Yeah, but I love it.
That's amazing. You have the patience for it. That takes a special person. Yeah.
So there's that whole academic side to number 12 that I really enjoy.
That makes sense. Now, you grew up a little north, like an hour or so north of New York. I'm terrible at being a transplant as to what is where and anything. I'm like, I know a little bit about Brooklyn, maybe a little bit about Queens, and I've been commuting into Manhattan for 12 years, so I know some of the streets of Manhattan. But I think I've been to the Bronx once. I think I was to go to the Bronx Zoo. Oh, twice. I bought some hi-hats from a guy in the Bronx.
Ah, okay.
And those
okay.
Some nice hi-hats.
Yeah.
So, all right, I've been to the Bronx twice. So needless to say, beyond that, I'm terribly ignorant of the locale of different places. So tell me a little bit about where you grew up and a little bit about your family, because you were saying that your family came over and...
Yeah, so my parents, they're both from Bratislava, Slovakia,
mm-hmm.
and they immigrated here during communism.
Yeah.
So they came to Westchester. So it's actually right above the Bronx.
Right.
Sleepy Hollow, Tarrytown is the area, right by the Tappan Zee Bridge.
Cool.
So I grew up there. And then I guess around when I was like 10 or 11, we moved further upstate.
Yeah.
To Orange County by Newburgh or what else is close by? Monroe.
Uh-huh.
Newburgh, Monroe, Tuxedo area. So so that's where I grew up. Went to school there. And then I went to college in SUNY New Paltz.
Gotcha. So. And growing up, how did you find the drums in the first place?
No one in my family really plays an instrument.
Yeah.
So I think third or fourth grade, you can pick an instrument at school. So I got percussion.
Right. Just playing snare drum in the concert band type
snare
thing?
Snare drum, bass drum, same thing. Xylophone.
Yeah.
Yep.
All that shit. Did you have to play the triangle?
Of course.
My God, you poor bastard.
Yeah. Those are some sad days. I still remember one of the most terrifying moments. I think it was my first concert. I had to play a train whistle. just, it's like that, like a wooden train whistle that you just blow.
Was that the one thing you did the whole time?
For one song, yeah.
Oh, okay, for one song. So,
and they put me in front of the orchestra, and it was, they gave me a microphone, and that's not percussion, in my opinion.
No.
And I was also, it was fourth grade, I was a little kid, so I was terrified.
Right.
But yeah, I still remember that.
That's amazing.
So it's been a long time since those days.
Wow. How did you end up getting your first drum set then?
After a few years and being in percussion, it was a birthday present for my parents.
What age?
I want to say it was probably like 6th or 7th grade, so maybe 14 or 15. Yeah. I think 14, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Or maybe even 13, yeah. 13 or 14, and it was this awesome Tama double bass.
Really?
Used drum set. Yeah, it was like the Lars Ulrich.
Mega set.
Yeah, exactly. Too big to start off on, but it was, right. It was fun for the time. Yeah.
And you were set up in the house, just banging away?
In the basement, yeah.
That's the way to see. You're lucky that y'all have basements up here in the South. We don't have basements.
Yeah, where was your drum set? Just in the...
Dude, it was in my room. So I was just blasting.
Nice.
And then the bands would come over and we'd practice in the room too. And I just unearthed, it's funny that we should even be talking about this, I just unearthed the first demo I ever recorded. And God, it's so fucking terrible, man. It's so terrible. I wanted to play some for my wife, and I was like, I can't even bring myself to play any of this. I could hear that we wanted to be Primus, you know? Yeah. We put this out in 94, I think, 93, 94, something like that. And it's hilarious, man, you know, when you think back. Have you gone back and listened to, like, recordings of your first band?
Yeah, you can hear the influences, like...
I mean, that's all you have.
That's it. You just have your main influence. It's like, yep, that's mine. And then, oh, the bass player, he loves Primus. Yeah, so there it is.
Right.
It's like four bands just stacked on top of each other, and that's it.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you remember the first show you ever played? What was your impression of that?
I do, yeah. It was at a... I don't know if you have it in the South. We have, it's like a American Legion Hall,
yes,
kind of stuff. Yeah.
Yep.
So it was just some local guy had a bunch of local bands playing there. So we played on the wooden floor. I guess someone let us borrow PA.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, I think my parents came, my grandma came.
Everybody came.
Yeah. So,
and they didn't tell you honestly how they felt about the music you were playing, right? Like,
I think they were just happy that we were going for it, but right. I mean, I'm pretty certain that it was terrible, and that they, I can't believe that they would support that, but I'm glad they did.
It's amazing. For the first show that I played as well, my dad showed up, a bunch of people showed up to it, and my dad took a bunch of pictures. So in my photo album, there's pictures of us on that first gig.
Yeah, and same with my mom. She's got the photo album with all of us there. Yeah,
that's amazing, man. What was your takeaway from that first gig? I remember thinking that it was like an out-of-body experience, and I thought, I can't wait to do this again. That was fucking awesome.
Absolutely. I still feel that way. I mean, live music, I don't think anything can compare to it, to performing live, and because you just have that moment. It's just you and the music.
Yeah.
And yeah, I think that's why I still do it, and that's why I pursue it so deeply, is from those first shows, I fell in love with it, just performing.
Right. Yeah. Now with Downfall, I'm sure you've played some pretty big festivals and stuff in front of pretty big crowds. I feel like I've seen some pictures of some pretty big, cool shows that y'all have played. Those are pretty, while awesome, do you kind of still enjoy and or miss playing more intimate venues and kind of being able to see more of the audience and kind of have a sense of how it's affecting them as opposed to sort of a bigger production, you know? I mean, both have their merits, but...
Yeah. I mean, luckily with the three bands, I get to play every kind of show. So like one week, for example, this Black Table Tour, we played some DIY spots.
Yeah.
Especially in Vegas and Santa Fe, I remember particularly. And
it's Santa Fe, New Mexico?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
And these young guys are still putting it together, and house shows. So there you really get to connect intimately with people, meet everybody, meet the promoter.
Right.
And that's always nice because you make these long lasting relationships.
Yeah.
And then on the other side, yeah, playing open air festival or something like this for thousands of people is always exciting. But yeah, you miss that connection with, mm-hmm. with the fans or with people that enjoy the music, because at the festivals you have everything taken care of, you have people setting up your backline for you, you just show up and play,
right?
And you have people selling your merchandise you don't even get to talk to people buying it. So it's just, it's interesting to see both sides.
Right.
Sure. Yeah.
Right. That's good that you have that polarity in your experience, you know, that you can experience all of that even within a year and playing with these different bands. Does it, scheduling wise, does it get to be a little tough at times scheduling all three bands?
For right now and up to now, it's actually been, pretty, and I don't want to say easy, but yeah. I haven't had any conflicts yet. Meaning, right. you know, if we have a tour offer, it hasn't been during another tour, something right. like that. So as of now, the cycles have been lining up.
Yeah.
For example, like one band will be writing a record, the other band will be touring on a record. So it kind of lines up nicely.
Yeah.
I think inevitably there will be a conflict and someone's going to get upset because, oh man, we got this really great tour offer. And I'll say, sorry, I already confirmed this one. So
right.
Well, I'll have to turn some stuff down. But yeah. As of now, I've just been saying yes to every tour, every festival for all three bands as, you know, as far as their schedules can accommodate. So.
Right. Now, as far as touring, and we've talked a good bit about it, how have you managed to leave yourself free enough of commitments to be able to pursue touring? Because that is always a tough balance.
Yeah, that's the toughest balance, I think, for anybody. So I've been teaching private music lessons since I graduated college.
Nice.
So I worked at my peak, I worked at three studios and I also had private students.
Uh-huh.
And over, since I joined Number 12, actually, I made a conscious decision to teach less and to really focus on the three bands.
Right.
So over the last 2 years, I've gradually quit each studio.
Uh-huh.
So now I have maybe eight private students that I, teach at my house or at their house and also via Skype on tour.
Yeah.
So, and these eight students, they're not just students, they're like almost like my family now. I've known them for a while and
right.
they really support my bands and they support me and they're sometimes even more excited than I am that I'm going on tour. Like, oh man, you're going away for a month to Europe. Yeah. Like
right.
have the best time. So they're overly supportive, which is nice. And, so far it's worked out really nicely actually.
Was there any particular moment where you were like, you know what, I'm throwing all the cards on the table, so to speak, and I'm just going to pursue this to the fullest extent? Did that start with Downfall, where you're like, all right, now this is like an even bigger thing? Or,
well, with Downfall, even when we toured, like let's say at the maximum, we toured, I don't know, 3 or 4 times a year.
Yeah.
It was still enough to hold all my studio jobs.
Right.
So luckily my bosses, they were also my friends. They understood and my students understood, you know, if, you know, students, they need a regular instructor.
Right.
But they also understood you play music for yeah. this, to perform, to record,
right.
not just, you don't just learn music to teach it right away.
Which in and of itself is a good lesson.
Yeah.
Right.
Exactly. So, when I joined Downfall, I didn't officially quit anywhere. But then when I joined Number 12, that's when it was a little too much. You know, for example, I left, I think, one tour for a month and I got back. I was home for 2 weeks and then I went on another 1 month tour. So
right.
for a student to not see me for, I don't know, 8 weeks out of 10 weeks, that's pretty bad, especially
right.
the young students who need somebody regular.
Absolutely.
So I left on good terms. And I would say this August, that was the point where I said, okay, I bought a Sprinter van.
Yeah.
A Mercedes Sprinter van for touring.
Which is also a big commitment.
Yeah, exactly. So I got that because I want to tour more. I'm going to do a backline service and a van rental also when I'm not here. And that's right, when we toured with Dillinger, actually in Europe. So that was the moment I'm like, okay, I want to pursue these three bands to the fullest. Any studio work, everything, just 100%.
Man, see, that's part of it is, once again, it's making that commitment, figuring out how to happen. So maybe the finance degree did come around because it sounds like you figured out some shit.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely appreciate having the business background because one thing with studying music at university is they don't tell you, hey, this is how you budget. This is how you
Absolutely
hustle.
Not.
They just say,
Absolutely
okay, this
not.
Is how you play music.
Right.
Okay, and all my... Most, I don't want to say all, a lot of my friends who graduated, they had no idea what to do. They just thought,
right.
okay, I have a degree, so now I'm a musician.
Yeah.
And that's not how it works. It's, you have to hustle, as you know, you have to find bands, you have to find gigs, you have to teach, I started a record label, so you have to have multiple income sources
right.
to make it feasible these days, especially.
Well, one of the tough things as well about teaching music business, quote unquote, also is that over the course of 4 years, this shit is constantly changing.
Of course. And it's every month, actually.
The music business, quote unquote, and I definitely quote that, is like, what even is the music business, you know? So you've got to figure out your own way, figure out who your audience is, and figure out ways around it and ways to sustain yourself so you can pursue music. And
absolutely.
That is a fucking puzzle. Yeah. So if you figured it out, kudos to you. That's all I got to say.
Still trying to, you know, put the pieces together.
Yeah. Well, man, you mentioned number 12 doing a run with Dillinger. How was it touring with them in Europe?
Really lovely. I mean, those guys are class acts and they have everything figured out. It's streamlined. They have a really small crew, but the, you know, from what I've heard, it's like a family vibe. So, it was just streamlined. The lights were on point, the sound, those guys are always tight. I don't think I've ever seen them make a mistake, even technical difficulties. A lot of bands, even these pros, something breaks, they're like, all right, we have to stop a song or something.
Fuck that.
These guys are breaking guitars every song, and you can't tell. I mean, the guitar is and broken in half, and all of a sudden their tech has another guitar in their in the guitarist's hands. So, yeah, it was really nice. They were very welcoming. Really sweet guys. I met a few of them previously. I recorded a record with Kevin at Backroom Studios.
Yeah.
So yeah, but really nice guys. Very friendly. So, yeah, it was a great tour.
It's another convergence of sort of dreamlike scenarios for you, in that a band that you were a big fan of in number 12, you end up playing with, and a band that's one of your favorite bands of all time, you end up opening up for that band in the Dillinger Escape Plan.
That was my dream tour. I mean, that's it.
That's crazy, dude.
I made a joke a few times after. I'm like, well, I guess I can quit now or whatever. It's where do I go from here? So...
Yeah.
But that was really, every day I had to pinch myself, be like, okay, I'm really watching Dillinger's soundcheck. Okay. And then I got to see their whole set. Cool.
Yeah.
And play before them.
Yeah, exactly, man.
So it was really surreal. Yeah.
Better playing before them than playing after them. That's the way I see it.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Ain't nobody want to play after that fucking band.
Yep.
No. The answer is no. Don't do it. It's crazy. Yeah, man. 20 years of that band. I'm going to one of these final shows. So
yeah, me too. I'll probably see you there.
Yeah, yeah. We'll talk about which date it was. I'm forgetting off the top of my head, but it's going to be a hell of a thing to see, man, and a great way to sign it off, man. They're rolling out on top.
Yep, absolutely. Top of their game.
Absolutely. And I mean, 20 years of that physically, I don't know how Ben has been able to sustain himself doing that shit.
I have no idea.
I'm sure he's physically a little fucked up from all that, but...
But he's still doing it.
Still doing it.
1,000%.
1,000%. The whole band, 1,000%, man.
Yep.
Killer. Well, Mike, good talking to you, man.
Yep. Thank you so much for having me.
All right, everybody, thanks for checking out this episode of Crash Bang Boom Podcast. Thanks to Mike Kadnar for being a rad dude and pretty handsome fella, too, if I have to admit. So be on the lookout for The Number 12 Looks Like You, Black Table, and Downfall of Gaia coming to a town near you, and what sounds like some upcoming recordings from all of his projects as well. Dude is a hustling, every day hustling. Gotta love it. Catch y'all on the next one. Crash Bang Boom!